Paulien van den Heuvel and Jerzy Reinders from the Amsterdam City Archive. And we will tell you about what works for us in combining crowdsourcing with Transcribus. We have Dutch mountains in our flatlands, and they consist mainly of paper. And our biggest mountain are the notarial archives. They're absolutely gorgeous, and it consists of many details, and the best part of it is most of all undiscovered territory. They consist of a lot of documents, millions of documents of 731 notaries, 3.5 kilometers, and we are getting to 7.4 million scans, and we're not even halfway. So it's a huge amount of undiscovered territory. A couple of years ago, since 2014, we started to climb this mountain. We started an index project, alle Amsterdamse akte, all Amsterdam deeds, on the crowdsourcing platform Vele Handen, Many Hands. And on that platform, anyone can make an account and log in, join the project, read some basic instructions, and start transcribing or whatever job there is. With the notarial archives, we kept that very basic because of the amount of documents. So what we ask of people to get very basic elements like person names, locations, dates of the deeds. You can see here that it looks like this. You can see here that's one problem with it. There's still a lot of information that will not get out this way, that will be hidden in the archives. And the second is that we have 30,000 of those big books, so it's going too slow. So we wanted to speed things up. We wanted to dig deeper and faster. So we thought, wouldn't it be great if you could search on every word on the page? And what if you would join the forces of the crowdsourcing, together with Transcribus? In that way, we could have all these volunteers and take as many documents, as many, put in as many data from many different handwritings and feed it to the HCR engine. So that worked. That's a new project, Crowd Leert Computer Lezen. The crowd teaches the computer how to read. And we started off very small, with a small project internally, where people made transcriptions from scratch. And later on, when we had our first models, we started a second project. Those people were only concentrated in correcting the HDR. But we were really sooner than expected, we were on a level that we could merge those two projects. And now we have only one where people are correcting. So it looks like this. It's just a normal, familiar interface of the web interface of Transcribus, only it's embedded in the Vele Handen platform. So there are some extra functionalities that help the user. First of all, they have their own profile, their login with personal statistics. They're in a corner, and personal statistics is something that we notice people really love a lot. And there are a lot of people that do like exactly 100 scans a day before they stop. They also have some extra buttons there, so they could keep it for longer if they wish to stop for a while and then continue a few days later. They can look at the next scan to see if maybe there is the next word, they can read it there or a different handwriting. And there's a button opmerkelijk, remarkable, for anything that they say like, hey, people should know this, this is fun. And it could also skip one, if you say it's too hard for me, never mind. So why Vele Handen and why not just use the Transcribus interface? Well, we could do that, but Vele Handen was there and our crowd is there. We've been working with Vele Handen since 2010. You can see here in the logo, it has more than 10,000 user accounts. So I think Pictura needs to update that. It's more than 16,000. 16,000, yeah. So you should have the updated logo. So I work in different projects there because the Notarial Archive is so extremely big. We split it in several projects so that people get statistics on the project. And it's also really nice to see this. To see the scores and to go towards 100%. That's very motivating for people. So that really works. And what we talked about is the forum. We don't use social media at all, but we have the own forum where people log in and leave messages and they get in discussions and they can just say like, hey, look what I found, but they're also sometimes really helping out each other. And the reason that we don't use social media is because we found it a little, confusing. Not everyone is on Twitter, not everyone is on Facebook. Some people like to be anonymous, and that's all possible here. It's very low-key. So who is our crowd? Personally, I never use the word crowd. I don't really like it. It sounds like you have this group of minions working for you as a workforce. We see it more as a team. We're working together. Of course, they're volunteers, and they come and go as they please. They can be anonymous. They cannot be anonymous. There are no targets, no entry levels, no selection at the gates, so anyone can join. So there are volunteers, and sometimes they're amateurs, have no historical background at all. But in these projects, you can see that if we work a lot, they see 10,000 of notarial deeds from a certain period, and they become experts really fast. The second part is that we try to hire interns, students, as much as possible. And also, we try to attract professional researchers. And for the professional researchers, also has benefits because they can share their expertise. We can ask them questions. But for them, there's something in there as well, because they're the first ones to know when something really interesting has been found. So it works both ways, and it gets diffuse. It's more like one team. And this you can see that we're really surprised. It's not from our projects, but from the whole VeLeHand crowdsourcing platform. They're really not only based in the Netherlands or Belgium. So they're working from all over the world. We like to add some fun as well. So we introduced a game called Rembrandt Bingo. Anyone that encounters Rembrandt, they call out bingo and they can collect a prize. And sometimes that can be Rembrandt, you know, his signature. There's really him as an active person in a deed. Sometimes it's just the bystander. I think last week we found a deed. I don't remember the details, but it was about the neighbors. A neighboring house from Rembrandt, but I don't know, for some reason we found out that Rembrandt had access to the water of the canal because he had a cellar under the house of his neighbors. Well, that's interesting information. And the last part is that Rembrandt can also be found in 18th century and 19th century documents because his paintings are listed in the probate inventories. And also that counts as a bingo because there's not much knows about the whereabouts of the Rembrandt paintings throughout the years. So that's, well, something that helps us in the process. We also like to meet. At least 3 times a year, we organize meetings for the people that want to come. Here with a Dutch writer, and we talk afterwards very informally. We also do that on the forum. We have direct interaction. So we can ask them questions, and sometimes very practical questions, like what tasks do you like most? Do you prefer to do the correction work, or do you prefer to work from scratch? Yeah, so there's a lot of direct interaction. Some people you never see. They're anonymous online, but others are really a close group, and we see them a lot. And they even organize themselves to be every Wednesday afternoon in our reading room to work together. So that's something that we really didn't organize at all, but it was an idea that came from them, and we said, fine, good idea. So we come and sit with them sometimes, and we bring them chocolate, and it works for everyone. So now to the results, because it sounds like fun, but it's also hard work. Right now we have more than 26,000 scans transcribed, and it means about 10,000 scans ground truth. We only call it ground truth if it's not only corrected once, but also validated once. You see, we are a little running behind, so we have a lot of validation work to do. We have 19 notary-specific models, and we combined a lot to one general 18th century model. And that is shared with Intrascriba, so anyone can use that. We have also general 17th century model, but we're not satisfied yet. So we want to add some more ground truth to it, and then only then you can use it. But it's coming this year, definitely. Some more to say about these results?
No.
No?
Yeah, I would like to talk about the things we did with these results, because as Pauline already announced, we made a lot of models. And one of our conclusions was that although, and also these days has been talked a lot about how many pages do you need ground truth before you have a good model, a very practical question. In a lot of the cases, people say, well, 100 pages will be fine. Our experience is yes, well, 100 pages can be fine if you're very lucky, but most of the time you need 100 up to, well, 300 or even more, 500 pages, and then you're for sure. On the other hand, making models bigger than 500 scans is quite useless, as you can see here in the margin. because what we did here is compare a little bit more than 500 scans ground truth with a model of 1,000 scans ground truth. And as you can see, the corrections are minimal, and then sometimes even there has been made a mistake by overcorrection. So it's not a real improvement at all. We also did some experiments, as Pauline said, with general models. Therefore, we found out that it's very important not to put just all your ground truth in one model, but just to create very equal portions. So we chose to work with portions of per notarial handwriting of 100 up to 300 scans. And we did this several times, and we found out that if I tried it for 8 notaries, for instance, the model was not sustainable enough. But I tried it later on when we had more ground truth for 15 notaries, and that worked very good. And that was the basic of our first 18th century general notarial model. And it was the first general model in the Netherlands, so it's really nice to have. And as said, we are still working on a further 17th century general model. The basic of this model, you can see it here, it has a character error rate of a little bit more than 5%. This was so good that I suddenly got a mail from Günther, and I'm of course very happy, and he said, wow, that's a very nice model. Can we offer you a keyword spotting demo, and Bertolt can help you with it? So I had some contact with it, and we have scanned now more than 7.5 million scans from this notarial archive. So a big deal of the scans concern 18th century notarial handwritings. And of course, this was a great pilot to see, of course, how keyword spotting works, but also to find out how general does this model work on unseen other notarial handwritings. And the results, we were really, well, thrilled. The results were really incredible. We selected 20 different notarial notaries, and we put just one inventory number of every notary in this new keyword spotting demo. You can find it on transcribus.eu/r/notarial. So in total there, you can find there 10,000 scans. And it looks actually the same as the Finnish court records. So it's just a demo, but it's very good to give you an idea of how to work with keyword spotting. And of course, we are also interested because we heard all the time this is a totally different technique, but we are only archivists, historians. So yeah, how does this difference look like? So we compared the output of one scan of HDR with the output of keyword spotting. And as you can see, I marked the differences. They are totally different. So it is, of course, a different technique. And that's really what we find out. But still, the results are very positive. And we are really convinced that this 18th century is an interesting thing. And one more experiment that we did was at the same time the National Archives of the Netherlands realized their specialist model, specialized on VOC documents, so East Indian documents of the East Indian Company. And they actually had the same set of ground truth. Our set in total was 2,600 scans, something like that, and they also had 2,000 plus scans ground truth. So it was, of course, very interesting to combine these two sets and retrain a completely new model, a combined model. And that's what we did. But if you have two different sets, one specialized in notarial Amsterdam handwritings overall, and one in East Indian documents, you want to test how good this works, of course, on other 18th century documents, because you want that every Dutchman or can use this model. So we needed another validation set, so really transcriptions, ground truth. And we contacted another partner in the Netherlands. It was Erika Kuipers from the project Chronicling Novelty, who also was a speaker yesterday. And we asked her, can we maybe borrow a few of your chronicles that are totally transcribed and use it as ground truth to test all these new models? And you can see the details here. And our conclusion is that indeed this combined model also works better than other specialist general models. So it's really a step forward for those who want to work with 18th century Dutch handwritings in general. So please use this. Another thing, totally different than working with 18th century handwritings, but still very interesting, is the cooperation with researchers. My position within the Amsterdam City Archives has been paid by a research project called Golden Agents, and they try to connect all kinds of 17th century documents and other databases in order to get a better grip on production and consumption in the Dutch Golden Age. And of course, when they heard that we were indexing this archive, where of course you can find the Rembrandts, they were very interested. How can we incorporate this interesting set in our research? And they were especially very interested in a specific kind of notarial deeds, the probate inventory. So it's a list of goods. And in these lists of goods, of course, you can find the possessions, the paintings, the sculptures, etc. So that's really highly interesting. But also a difficult source, because it's not just text, it's not a table, as I found out yesterday. But yeah, you have to manage in a different way with this. And the researchers of the Golden Agents project, we delivered, of course, the ground truth and also HDR output of different of these probate inventory sets for them. And they, of course, were very happy, let's say that as first. But they also saw different problems. And one of the problems is, of course, that you want to have all the values, the taxations of the paintings, for instance. You want those, this kind of information you want to get out of the source, because it's really structured. You can find it in a very structured way there. But technique is a little bit lacking there. Sometimes the line segmentation is missing things. It's a little bit problematic, but we found out that with regular expressions we can tackle some problems. But well, I'm not convinced if that's still the level we want to offer the stuff, so we are looking further how to improve this. The next step within this project, and it's very nice to see, is of course that the matching you can actually do is very interesting. There are tesori, for instance, the Getty, an institute that of course also works on provenance. And what we found out is that we already can match the HDR selected within this specific yellow box, that we can already match that with, we can already get out really the objects on object level from the HDR, and we can already match that with the thesaurus. So that's really a step forward. And of course the people, the Getty Institute is an institute from the in America, and of course the people there are very interested how to link to these original sources where this all was described, and of course they are very interested in what is more to find.
Yeah, the truth is sometimes messier, of course, even how great this product is. Reality can look like this, a little messy. And the first thing about it is complete logistics of just bringing metadata, data and scans from vele handen to the transcribers platform and out again in exports. We need the scans in two places, and it's a lot of handwork, really, still. And also the export functions, for practical reasons, we stick to the units of the one book. So also for the export, we do that one by one. So we do it job by job, and then we know the coffee cup icon really well. And also, yeah, also what you find is it's not really meant for big amounts of scans and data. And we want to work with really on a larger plan.
Yeah, one of the problems I already agendized was is the problem with the line segmentation. Of course, we're very happy that it has been improved over the last years in a very positive way. But still, we find that we have problems, and not only for the probate inventories, but also for other kinds of notarial deeds. Here you see an example of a notary who has quite big spaces between the words, and then he doesn't recognize it as whole lines. I find it actually very stupid, because to the human eye, it's very clear that these are lines. Also with capital letters, there are sometimes problems. And foreign languages also are a challenge. I already yesterday got some tips from Dirk Alverman, and I think I'm going to use a base model to tackle this problem, but I really hope that it works. But I will come back to that in the next Transcribers User Conference, probably.
Yes, a dream set we have. So already we wanted to go bigger than was possible within Transcribers, the expert tool now. Because we have some specialist models of certain notaries, and wouldn't it be great to just, you know, use this model and then process all scans from its notary in one time? You know, it could be 100 or 200 or 300,000 scans. And of course, we want everything to be searchable within our own collections, and not only the notary archive, but anything we have. And of course, even better, all handwritten text documents in the Netherlands. And further, we would look at more diverse talks and flexible tools to maybe use within Transcubus or outside, or maybe in our solution for the end user. We're not certain about that yet, but we think we can do more and maybe merge projects and make better use also that of the tools that Transcubus has to offer now. So we have big dreams. I think we're getting there, we're on the way, but sometimes we still feel like the man in his picture. That says like, well, look, we had all these boxes of paper and we have now a lot of boxes with data. Now what? We're only at the beginning. So we have a potential, I think, of only with the 18th century model of 2 million scans that we could process right away. We're ready for the next step. But as we heard yesterday, of course, something is holding us back and there is a price tag. And of course, we knew this was coming. I think we just chose to ignore it, so it was no longer possible. So we made an estimate, and it was before the talk of yesterday. Like for instance, Daniel van den Brink, one of our notaries with a pretty good specialist model, he has about 230,000 scans that we could just, you know, like to process today. But only, I estimated a price tag of around 25,000 euros. Which we don't have. And it was a little optimistic side, because yesterday we heard even heavy user, you would think of 17 cents per scan, so it's closer to 40,000. That is without membership discounts, but it's still this amount of money. And as probably the case is for most of you, we do not get structural funding for either scanning or those projects. So we always have to be really creative. Another notary is Hendrik Schaaf, very interesting, and that would be around 3,000. Now that sounds a lot better, that sounds doable, maybe for us, but also maybe for researchers. We are trying to interest people to maybe take it up in their research grant and then, you know, be creative to maybe exchange the model and the scans and get the HR in return from them. So, and that's also one of the reasons why we haven't shared a specific model yet, that we're looking into it in creative ways to get the money to get the HR. So if anyone thinks of better creative solutions, just let us know, because we really want to go on and we can't. So if you're looking at the scans of only the notary archives that we have now, we're looking at 1.2 million that we need for only the HR processing. The plan things for all scans of notary archive, 2.5 million, well, let's double that for all handwritten documents that we have in the city archives. So we need a little bit of more money.
Yeah, and of course, several of these points have been mentioned, but this financial obstacle won't let us down. We just proceed with what we have been doing so far, working on the 17th century in the new model, try to work on an even better layout analysis. Yeah, and I already mentioned the working with the base model. And this afternoon we also have a meeting with all the Dutch partners. There is really an active group of Dutch Transcribus users present. And we are also always discussing how can we work, strive towards the realization of a Dutch model. Yeah, and we will just proceed with this struggle. And something in general, of course, is where this all comes together with the indexing project, etc., is of course that we want to realize the eternal dreams of the digital humanities via this project. It will take some time, but we are on our way.
Yeah, we would like to stay aboard, but we hope to break the bank.
Yeah, thank you very much for your attention, and I'm not sure if we have any time for questions left. Yes, there is time for questions left, so if you have any questions, please feel free to...
Thanks very much. It's a really fascinating project. I'd like to ask, is it possible for you to estimate how much time or resource you dedicate for engaging with your the user community, your volunteers? So you mentioned that you don't do social media, but you have a forum and you organize these events face-to-face.
Yes, the events really, but mainly because it's getting a community, we don't really do that much. So it's kind of, you know, we just started.
So it has its
roles, and some people take on the role of like a super user, and they take on other volunteers, and it's really a community that helps themselves. So sometimes, you know, we really like people ask questions, and of course we have to pamper them and organize things. But overall, everyone is really happy to join, and we don't really have that much work for it.
And if I can add something to that, we ourselves are active on Twitter, and I of course work at a research institute, so if very specialist questions come up, we always try to do our best to bring bring these questions of the volunteers under the attention of professional researchers and just provide them with the answers as quick as possible. So there is a kind of time investment, and also in the weekends, I mean, we have some colleagues, and yeah, people are, if you sometimes only react on a Saturday, people are appreciating that so very much. I mean, why would you, just for your work, react in the weekend? So they also see that it's your passion, and that, yeah, it's really an exchange.
A group of lovers, I think.
Yeah.
Thank you. Could I also ask the resulting transcriptions that you get from the platform, apart from putting that on the keyword supporting platform, which you've showed, is there a plan to then integrate it within the archive?
Yeah, definitely.
Catalog and make it
We would like that tomorrow, but unfortunately, all our systems are under construction. And in a new version, yeah, it would be like placed in probably some kind of OCR viewer kind of state where you see the scan and the transcription, and also download the transcription, probably something like that. In the meantime, because it will take a year, 2 years, I don't know, we need some solution to get this to people that can use it, and we're not sure in what form we will do that, probably in some easy download.
You were talking about merging your model with the one from the National Archives. I was wondering if you run into any issues concerning kind of different rules or approaches to transcribing, for example, abbreviations or special characters or so on.
I think actually we didn't, because what we did is, and we did the same with Erika, is that we developed a kind of instruction based on communication with the transcribers team, because there wasn't anything for a Dutch model. And also we shared it with Lisbeth from the National Archives, and we shared it with Erika from the Chronicles project. So everybody is, I think, in some way working with the same basic rules. So we didn't really run into problems. So that's also one of the things we are doing as a Dutch group. We have 1-2 annual meetings, and then we discuss these kind of things and just exchange new insights. So yeah, that's really helpful.
Could you tell us more how you deal with researchers? Did I understand you right that researchers do full transcriptions, and how do you tempt them to make full transcriptions? What do you give them in return in order to tempt them?
Well, not everyone does full transcriptions. More are more advising, but some do pitch in and do also the hard work. And what really works for us is almost a kind of notification system. Because I said this is most of all untrodden territory. People are really waiting for that, you know, that Rembrandt scoop that no one has found before. And that's our benefit. They can be the first one to hear about it. So sometimes they can place a message on a forum and just say, like, hey, I'm interested in gardens in 18th century, or I'm interested in slavery or in diplomats. You know, any volunteer finding this, please let us know here. And volunteers love that. They have an extra task to do, so they work as a notification service for the researchers. So that works really well. Yeah.
And to be honest, if you mean are researchers really transcribing a lot of scans, no. No. It are mostly really the volunteers who do the actual work. So just sometimes retired people, for instance, but also interns.
We exchange, and they have already transcriptions, and we can share it with our models. So we barter a lot to make things possible.
If there aren't any more questions, thank you a lot for this interesting insight.